Hi, Chris here, and it's been a while since I've taken a look at a 15.6 inch more budget oriented laptop, and this one was sent out to me from Teclast. It is called the F15 Pro. Now, it is powered by a Core i5, it's 10th gen, the 1005G1. It has integrated graphics, Intel's UHD, but it has 32 executional cores, which is slightly better than what we've seen, say, on some of the other older generation chips, like the 8th gen, for example. Now, this model here, it does come with 256 gigabytes of storage, 12 gigabytes of RAM, Wi-Fi AC, so it's not Wi-Fi 6, Wi-Fi AX. With Bluetooth 5 would have been a lot better, so sadly it's one area it's definitely lacking in. It has a 53 watt hour battery, and in this review I'll be going in detail, we'll take a look at this laptop, and I'll let you know, is it worth the 420 or so asking price that Teclast is after for this particular spec of Windows 10 home laptop? This laptop weighs 1.93 kilos for a 15.6 inch laptop, that's not too bad. Now, with our 57 watt charger, the total travel weight then is 2.21 kilos. So looking at our build here, we've got a plastic palm rest. The touchpad is nice and large. However, I find the finer movements to be very irritating with these ones. The cursor jumps around all over the place. So I would rate this really as a very poor touchpad. I like the size of it, and yes, it does have our left and right mouse buttons in it. Now, no backlighting with these keys at all. It's good to have the number pad, the full-size arrow keys. These shortcuts all along the top, they work without having to use the function key. So you just need to use the function for the F keys along the top there, and that is it. Now, pressing down in here, there's not really much flex. The keyboard to type on, you get around 1.4 to 1.5 millimeters of travel, which is very standard. We've got our four little speakers up the top right here, some status LEDs, and the keyboard does make a bit of a rattle kind of noise when you do type on it. I'd say it's an okay keyboard, this one. It's just that touchpad I'm not very happy with. Our lid here, this is made out of a brushed alloy with a matte paint finish on it, and it does pick up smudges a little bit. Pressing down here, there really is no flex on that, and it doesn't feel bad. Now, the hinge stiffness, it cannot be opened up one-handed, and it does make a few creaks in the chassis, which is all really plastic. This is the only metal it's got, really, is just the lid here, and you do hear that when you open it up. Ports on the right side, gigabit LAN, this is Realtek, USB 3.0, we have a microphone and audio out, so that's good, and the quality on it is not too bad. This micro SD card slot, the micro SDs sit in flush, which is great, but it's still only just USB 2 speed, so I get a maximum of 27 megabytes per second through that one. And then here on the left, we've got a Kensington lock slot, HDMI, right there, full size one, and it's type C. Now, it looks like it supports power delivery, but with all my power delivery chargers, I'm not actually able to charge this one at all, which is very disappointing. I don't know what is going on, or maybe I've got a faulty unit. It just does not seem to be working. No display out via this one either. So this is HDMI 2.0, so 4K 60, DCN 19 volts for charging with the charger I showed you before, of course, and another USB 3.0. And then the underside here, we've got four rubber feet, intake vent, there is a screw in the middle. This is why the keyboard doesn't seem to have any bounce or flex, which is a good move from them. And I'll open this up now and we'll take a look at the internals. And the first thing you notice here is look at the crazy amount of free space. I'm talking all of this, okay? This is just some tape there that's holding down a cable that goes to this PCB right there. But it's only this part here. We've got the cooler with the two copper heat pipes and just a small little fan. It is very quiet. It seems to always be at the same constant RPM. So that's one positive, that the fan noise in this particular unit is very, very good. Our Teclast branded SSD, which is SATA 3, and I'll get onto the speeds of that one shortly. A 53.58 watt hour battery, which is good for around 8 hours to 9 hours, depending on what your brightness is and your use. Wireless antennas are located down here in the palm rest. Now, this is metal, so it has a metal backing plate on it. So they really could have put a huge battery in this. They could have used the space here. There could have been some two more cells up here, perhaps even move this down, fit more in. So they could have put like a 70 watt hour battery in this, and they could have even put a second slot in here for another SSD, but they didn't do that in this one at all. And looking now at our screen, so this one is covered in glass and it's not fully laminated, which is disappointing. IPS panel has a maximum brightness of 226 nits, which is lower than what I like to see in a laptop. And for me, the minimum really is 300 nits. So we've got a color gamut coverage here of 70% P3, Adobe RGB is 70% also, and NTSC that is 65%. sRGB with this one is 93%. It's a 1080p panel. Viewing angles for an IPS are fine, and it's just that brightness really, which is the main thing. I do wish that this screen was a lot brighter, especially considering the fact that it has the glass on it and it is quite reflective, so it's not an anti-glare matte coated screen, which would have been better here too. And now for a sample from the webcam, which is housed in the top bezel, that rather large bezel that this laptop does have. So if I stop talking for just a second, hopefully you heard that coming through. There's this buzz and interference coming through on the two microphones, which are on the underside of this particular laptop. Now the HD quality here with the video, it's about 20 frames per second to 15 frames per second. It's not even 30 frames per second. So overall, webcam quality, microphone quality is poor, just like the speakers on this unit. Now speakers, they're just located up here and they are really quite poor. They're terrible speakers, they lack in volume, there's no bass to them, they're very, very flat. Here's a sample of them at 100% volume. And now just going through the Windows setup. So we do have these pre-installed language packs on here. So there's quite a few languages already part of this Windows 10 image, which is good. And here we are with our desktop. So you get this interesting background from Teclast that is different, T-Bolt. And no, that does not mean it has Thunderbolt 3. It's missing. Type-C port on this, as I pointed out before, does not accept power delivery, at least with not all of my power delivery charges, which is disappointing there. Now that 4K, definitely HDMI 2 with that one, so I'm able to get from the HDMI port, 4K 60Hz, which is fine with this kind of spec. And under the system right here, just to point out that Windows 10 does have a valid key, and it is Windows 10 Home with this. And you will need to run a few Windows updates, I guess, get these security patches and everything, and all that up to date as expected. Now, the gigabit, that's Realtek. Okay, and yeah, that's gigabit, that's fine, that's good to see this. We don't normally have on these kind of laptops a LAN port, believe it or not. Wireless, however, Realtek Wireless, it's the 8821CE, disappointing speeds. I'm only getting throughput around 300 megabits per second from this. They should have gone with the Intel AX200 like most of the tech we see now. Even with the Gemini Lake and the Jasper Lake lower end chips, we do get the Wi-Fi 6 support, and this is Wi-Fi 5. Wi-Fi AC, and it's only got Bluetooth 4.2 instead of Bluetooth 5 with this, which is disappointing. Here we have the Intel UHD graphics, that is 32 executional cores with the Ice Lake here. It's a step up from what we have on the previous, say, 8th gen Core i3, so there is an improvement there, and I'll get onto gameplay later on in this video. And I do just have a couple other things to point out. So our SSD speeds, yeah, they're okay for SATA 3, not too bad. I mean, the sequential writes could be better. 4K randoms, they're not too bad there. Now, this is Teclast's own brand of SATA 3 SSD that they are using in this. And the other thing too is just a few benchmarks. I won't go too over the top with benchmarks because this is super low end. Two cores, four threads, 3.4 gigahertz maximum turbo. And this is our OpenCL score for the graphics, just over 5,000 points, which is low. And this is very low too as well. So single core score, scraping over 1000 for such a low turbo, 3.4, I guess that score is fine. It's okay. Multi-core score here though is abysmal. This is low, okay? And you do see this when you push it hard, when you want to multitask and things, it's a little bit slower there. So this one, of course, only having the two cores, the four threads, and that low turbo is why we have such a low score with that. I'll take a look now at just a little bit of YouTube performance here. So I'm right here now and I wanted to search a 4K demo just to bring up and see how is that going to perform with this wireless chipset from Realtek. So I will put this onto 4K preset and full screen this. All right, It's a little slow in the beginning to start, and to turn on the stats, of course. So we're looking at no drop frames here with this. Okay. So it's working all right, and my buffer health is actually not too bad for my connection. So YouTube, 4K, it can, because of the 32 executional cores on the UHD graphics, handle this just fine. The same goes with UHD video, VP9 codec. It will actually be able to play all of that just fine here with the integrated graphics. So I'll stop that, and what I want to do is just a Chrome tab test. Can you multitask on this with a lot of Chrome tabs? You can. Now, on memory, this is running at 3.2 gigahertz. That's one of the positives of very few, really, with this particular machine here, that we do have at least the decent speeds here. It is in dual channel. Now, this is soldered onto the motherboard, so there are no possible RAM upgrades with this one here. I'm just going to search cats, bring up a lot of tabs, and we'll see how it handles this. I do expect it to choke a little bit because, well, really, it's not a real powerful system here. We're looking at only, of course, the two cores. It's Core i3. It is low end. So I think that's about really it that I want to bring up when it comes to tabs and swapping over to these. So some of these are Wikipedia. That's very, very light. So no problems there. IMDb is showing a little tiny bit of lag just scrolling through that there, that it's not super fluid and smooth. And this one looks okay. So these other websites are loading in. So if you planned to run, say, about 10 tabs here in Chrome, that is not going to actually be a problem. And the memory, I've still got plenty left there. So for these kind of light tasks, light computing, this Core i3, I think, is adequate. It's fine for that, for just browsing, like documents as well, and spreadsheets will be okay on this, all right? I'm not showing them, but they actually will run just fine on this. So all of those light computing needs is really all this is good at. And a quick look at gaming performance, Counter-Strike, 720p, lowest possible settings. So the frame rate here in the late 50s, mid 40s, wow, with a few lags for some reason. This server could be my ping actually just now. Seems to be quite choppy and laggy. And not looking great. This 720p only on the lower settings, and it is struggling here, especially when there's a grenade or there's smoke grenades being thrown out. It will definitely choke and lag a little bit. So someone's got a sniper rifle up there. Ah, oh, and I was shooting up in that area. Okay, he got me. So not amazing performance. I just think this is a little bit too laggy. You would not be buying a Core i3 for gaming anyway. Temperatures, they are not looking very good here. So we reached 91 degrees, but we did not trigger any thermal throttling. It did trigger the power limit. Okay, so power limit exceeded. That is normal. That's always going to happen. And the fan noise has been very good. So most of the time is actually off with light tasks. It doesn't come on at all. And when it is on, you really don't hear it that much. And the top of the keyboard on the left-hand side does get a little warm to the touch, but it's not hot.
And now to quickly touch on our Linux support here. So volume controls and the brightness controls are working. Touchpad is working, but what's not working is the wireless for some reason. It doesn't like this Realtek chipset. And this is on the latest Linux Mint distro here that I'm testing out. So that's the only problem we're going to have. We have to find the driver for the Realtek wireless card if you intend to use Linux.
Okay, now battery life, very important. In a laptop, we've got a slightly larger battery than what I typically see with these brands. They normally always use 38 watt hour, 39 or 37 watt hour batteries. This one has 53. Now paired up with a 15 watt processor, it's not quite as good as you'd get, say, out of a Jasper Lake or Gemini Lake laptop, but we've got a little bit more performance on offer. At least the single core scores are a little bit better there. So it will go for around about 8 to 9 hours of my testing. The battery takes about 3.5 hours to fully charge, so it's not a quick charging battery there at all. And the performance in general for light computing is okay. So YouTube videos, documents, and just general kind of media consumption is all that I would do on a laptop like this. I would not edit video, would not do anything demanding. And even gaming, as you saw, it does have the Ice Lake chip in this. Okay, 32 executional cores, but it's held back by low turbos. The CPU is only a dual core. It's only 3.4 gigahertz maximum there. So it's nothing amazing. Keyboard is okay to type on. The build quality, plastic palm rest, plastic on the bottom, metal on the lid. And when I open it up, I can hear some creaks coming through in the chassis of this. That is the full maximum angle there that the screen will go back, which is, it's okay. That brings me on to the countless cons with this particular model. So the touchpad is terrible. I don't like it at all. The cursor goes all over the place with very light or finer movements. Gesture triggering in Windows 10 with the gestures doesn't seem to be great at all. So it's not a good touchpad. Speakers are very poor and weak. Microphones have interference. Webcam is poor. The screen brightness is only 226 nits or so. Poor, it's not fully laminated, so you get a lot more reflections. You get the ugly gap between the glass on the front and then the IPS panel below. So it's got a lot of things going against it. Type-C port doesn't support power delivery. It just goes on and on. So for the 420 or so euros asking price on AliExpress, on Teclast's store there, what they want for this particular laptop, I don't see it happening. I think it's overpriced for the spec on offer, and then all of those cons there. So now you know the full story here of Teclast's F15 Pro, 10th gen, Core i3 laptop, Windows 10 Home. Is it something to get or consider? I would only consider it if that price really dropped down and you just needed a basic laptop for very, very light computing. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope to see you in the next one with a much better product than this one here from Teclast.